You're listening to the audio production of Courageously Expecting, 30 Days of Encouragement for Pregnancy After Loss by Jenny Albers, published by Thomas Nelson and read by Jenny Albers.
For Luke, thank you for loving me through the darkness and walking in faith when I could not. I love you. For Annabelle and Axel, you bring nothing but light and color to my life. You're both my favorites. For Micah and my baby without a name, you've impacted my life for the better. You are forever loved. Introduction, an invitation to carry on in courage. Motherhood was supposed to be the happily ever after that came second only to marriage. When my husband and I decided we were ready to start a family, I had a vision of what that would look like, of how motherhood would go. I'd get pregnant exactly when I wanted to. We'd have three children, each 3 years apart, and we'd carry on unscathed, never knowing that sometimes these things don't go as planned. My vision didn't include loss or complicated pregnancies, but those things became part of my reality anyway, and more than once, the maternal happiness I'd pictured was replaced by grief. Sure, I knew that miscarriages happen, and maybe I even had a vague understanding that sometimes babies die, though the idea of that was far too obscure for me to actually comprehend. As absurd as it sounds now, that's about all I knew. I was mostly unaware that pregnancy doesn't always go as planned. The term stillbirth had never been on my radar. In fact, I don't think I'd ever heard the word uttered. I'd seen something about an ectopic pregnancy in a TV drama, but failed to consider that such things can happen in real life, too. And as far as complications in pregnancy go, I figured morning sickness was about it. Never could I have imagined that I would lose not one baby, but two. After a healthy and perfectly normal first pregnancy, I thought our future as a family was set, believing two more babies would join us as easily as the first one had. I had no reason to believe that the storyline for my subsequent pregnancies would unfold in any way other than that of my first, ending with a baby in my arms. But I quickly discovered that's not always the case, even when pregnancy crosses into the safe zone of the second trimester. Less than 6 weeks into my second pregnancy, a niggling pain in my lower right side vied for my attention. Though I knew better, I didn't give it much thought until it intensified to the point that I could no longer deny it, or the reality that it was likely a serious threat to my baby and my body. After trying to push through, even running errands and engaging in my daughter's preschool dance class, I ended up writhing on the living room floor in unspeakable pain. Something was wrong. Hours later, in the frenzied atmosphere of the ER, I discovered I was experiencing an ectopic pregnancy. The fertilized egg, which held the very beginning stages of my baby's life, had implanted in my fallopian tube rather than my uterus, and the microscopic being inside me would never grow to see the world outside my body. With my daughter well on her way to her third birthday, the plans for my children to be spaced 3 years apart fell to pieces. 9 months later, I became pregnant again. After an early ultrasound confirmed that the pregnancy was viable and that the fertilized egg had indeed implanted where it was supposed to, I felt relieved. And yet, I still sensed that something was off. Even as my pregnancy progressed into the second trimester with no sign of trouble, I couldn't settle comfortably into the idea of bringing my baby home. Almost 1 year to the date of my ectopic pregnancy, at 17 weeks and 6 days pregnant, my water broke, sending my first pregnancy after loss into a tailspin of ER visits and appointments with maternal fetal medicine specialists. For nearly 3 weeks, my baby and I held on. The prognosis wasn't good, and while I certainly believed that God could save my baby's life, I didn't get the impression that a miracle was on the horizon. In fact, I knew my baby was going to die, but I carried him until his heart and my body gave out. Micah was born silent and still on January 31st, 2015, at which point the vision I'd had for growing our family went black. For months, my husband and I agonized over whether or not to try conceiving again. After two consecutive losses, it seemed unlikely that something would go right in a future pregnancy. Choosing to hope felt daunting, and just the potential of experiencing another loss felt like more than my heart could handle. Even if I did become pregnant again, I knew that my unencumbered days of pregnancy were over. No longer did I associate carrying a child with joy and the anticipation of cradling a newborn baby against my chest. No longer would my experience of pregnancy be carefree, with the biggest concerns being how to decorate the nursery, choosing the perfect baby name, or deciding whether to buy the gray or the black car seat. No longer was success promised. No longer did becoming pregnant foretell the arrival of a new family member. But we carried on anyway, my heart mustering the courage to hope for another living child, while my head told me it was too risky. Which is why, in November 2015, when two pink lines stared at me from behind the small plastic window of a pregnancy test, I felt more bewildered than anything. I was pregnant for the fourth time. The year had started with loss and was ending with new life, but how long that life might last was a mystery. Most people would say I was expecting, but it was more complicated than that. What was I expecting? Was I expecting life or death? Was I expecting to leave the hospital with or without my baby? Was I expecting a full-term birth or an early death? And even in the case of a full-term birth, I knew I wasn't guaranteed to deliver a living child. In my experience, the people familiar only with positive pregnancy outcomes were oblivious to the contradictory feelings and complexities that accompanied pregnancy after loss. It was as if becoming pregnant again erased the two previous pregnancies and the memory of the babies who once existed but didn't survive. Those around me all seemed so enthusiastic. Unlike me, they automatically viewed my pregnancy as normal, as if there were nothing at all to be concerned about. To them, of course it was a pregnancy that would end with a baby, prompting few concerns greater than sore nipples and sleepless nights. But I knew that was only if my body cooperated. Now, don't get me wrong. I was surrounded by people who loved me and cared about my unborn baby. But the comments meant to assure me that all would end well only made me feel misunderstood and alone. Before loss, the idea that the emotions surrounding pregnancy could be so complicated had never entered my consciousness. Joy, excitement, glee, these were the feelings I was supposed to have. But fear, anxiety, and a sense of doom? Well, like loss, such things aren't typically discussed in the pregnancy guidebooks. But as any mom who has experienced loss knows, these feelings are the reality of pregnancy after loss, which only left me feeling more isolated in my grief. Friend, does any of this sound familiar? The emotional turmoil, loneliness, and feeling that you don't quite fit in with other pregnant women, not to mention the grief that still lingers from losing a precious baby? Even when we cling to hope, fear is ever present and trying to pry it from our grip. But amid the swirl of our emotions is a steady God. He is our certainty when pregnancy is not. Hope is hard. I think most women who are pregnant after loss would agree that it's the second hardest experience of their lives. To lose a baby is the hardest, but to choose to hope for life after loss, knowing that it might not come, well, that may as well be the definition of hard. But you know what else it is? Courageous. Because choosing to try again when fear is ever present and nothing is promised is not for the faint of heart. Even when we feel misunderstood by the world at large, even when we feel alone in the uncertainty of how pregnancy will end, God sees our hardship and is right there with us. I'm not sure I've ever been as afraid or ever relied as much on God as when I was pregnant after losing Micah, when loss no longer seemed like a so-called fluke. Pages and pages of my journal, scribbled with notes about anxiety and hope and gratitude and uncertainty, along with prayers and scripture references, are proof of my need for God. They reflect my deep fear, pronounced sorrow, breath-stopping panic, and cautious hope, with pleas to strengthen my body and my faith, laid before God in black and white. And that's what you'll find in these pages too. The authentic and valid emotions that are part of the pregnancy after loss journey, and the reality that God, in His goodness, has not left us to travel it alone. Because of God's presence, His grace, and His promises, we can navigate the threatening waters of pregnancy after loss with courage, despite the inevitable waves of turmoil. Because courage isn't the absence of fear. It's moving forward and tackling challenges despite fear. Whether you're pregnant again or still in the stages of considering becoming so, it is my prayer that this book will remind you that you aren't alone. I'm walking with you as a mom who knows the devastation of losing a baby and the anxiety around trying to carry another one into existence. And the God who delights in the creation of new life as much as you do walks ahead of us both. Courageously expecting isn't about knowing what comes next. It's about choosing to look for beauty, goodness, and hope right now, in the midst of a pregnancy so often marked by uncertainty and fear. For 30 days, you'll journey with me through my own pregnancy after the loss of Micah. You'll stop to pray, reflect on how loss has colored your subsequent pregnancy, and be encouraged to move forward in faith. You'll also find letter writing prompts to help you connect with your baby during a time in which bonding can be difficult. I don't expect that any of this will change the difficulties of your circumstances, but my hope is that it will help sustain you by showing that you are fully seen. Friend, as you embark on this journey of pregnancy after loss, I pray you'll find the strength to carry on in courage and faith. Day 1. The Courage to Try Again. For I am the Lord your God, who takes hold of your right hand and says to you, do not fear, I will help you. Isaiah 41:13. The morning sun accentuated the leaves dangling outside my window, drawing my attention to stunning shades of yellow, orange, and red. The world had turned warm and golden, and though winter's bitter conditions seemed a distant memory, a chill continued to rattle my bones. I hadn't forgotten the circumstances that had landed me in the hospital on a cold January night months earlier. In fact, the trauma and heartache of that night were still fresh as my body, heart, and mind continued to grieve the baby who was born but never took a breath. The chill of death haunted me, and the world felt cold. The baby I had carried for over 20 weeks had slipped silently into heaven. The delivery room was quiet. No crying, no clapping, no congratulatory shouts, no laughter, just sorrow and the hush of death. I held my baby in the palms of my hands, trying to memorize his face, his fingers and toes, his weightlessness, before returning his tiny, still body to my nurse. Luke and I named our precious, gone-too-soon baby Micah. Then we made plans for his remains and completed my discharge paperwork. I left the hospital feeling defeated, returning home with an empty womb and arms that longed to hold the child who had been formed within me. My own child had left this earth a stranger because I hadn't had the chance to meet him before his heart stopped beating. A few weeks after that awful night, with tearful eyes and a shaking voice, I timidly asked my doctor when it would be safe to try conceiving again. She advised that I wait at least 6 months to allow my body and my heart time to recover. Thus began the months of simultaneously tracking how many weeks pregnant I should be while counting down the weeks to when I could, potentially, become pregnant again. Under normal circumstances, I would have still been counting down the weeks to my due date, to Micah's expected arrival. But Micah was already gone, and because of that, there was an acute emptiness in my womb that physically hurt. Though I was eager for that emptiness to be filled, the thought of it terrified me. The days crept by, and I watched the scenery of the natural world slowly change. Colorful tulips and sunny daffodils appeared in places that had been snow-covered and barren. Carpets of lush green grass and bright dandelions were a welcome change from winter's drab landscape and spring's unpredictability, signaling the arrival of the time when, according to my doctor, it was safe to try again. The world was coming back to life all around me, and while I longed for my womb to do the same, I wasn't yet ready to pursue another pregnancy. I knew all too well that it would never truly be safe to do so because, just like spring weather, pregnancy had proven to be anything but predictable. After experiencing pregnancy loss, one might find it difficult to imagine that any pregnancy might have a positive outcome. Women routinely experience successful pregnancies, and babies are born alive and healthy every day. But when you're heartbroken and observing the unfolding of a story you desperately want to be a part of, those things can seem like an impossibility. When your own pregnancy has ended with the words, "I'm so sorry."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.